Thank you very much. I do hope, I mean, we had about 18 speakers today and there was only 2 women speakers. So girls, next time, please come along. It's better here than there. My name is Linda Polman. I'm a freelance journalist. I work for the 2 Dutch national newspapers and increasingly also for foreign newspapers. Since 1993, I have been following the war zones, especially those war zones where there have been foreign military interventions and also foreign humanitarian interventions. I got involved into that part of journalism by accident, really. I used to be a travel story writer, put on my backpack. I used to travel from Cairo to Cape Town, for example, and write stories about that and sell that to newspapers. Until one day, this was in 1993 already, I was at home in Amsterdam, you know, watching the television, telephone rang, I picked it up, and it was a friend of mine who was a freelance photographer from England. And he said, Linda, I'm calling you to say goodbye because I can no longer make a living as a freelance photographer. I've accepted a job working for a catering company in Somalia. So I said, well, goodbye, have fun. When you come back, return and tell me what it was like. I hung up the phone and it was only hours later that I realized what he had actually said. He was going to work for a catering company in Somalia. At that time, I didn't know a lot about Somalia, but what I did know was that there was a famine, there was a hunger. So this combination of catering and hunger in Somalia, I found that so intriguing that I decided to go and follow him, to find him, to see what he was actually doing in Somalia. So this was a turning point in my life. I did end up in Somalia, in the capital of Mogadishu. I got a lift with the United Nations. There were no commercial flights going because Somalia was engaged in a heavy war. It still is, by the way. I got a lift on a UN aircraft very, very willingly. And they just dumped me on the landing platform in Somalia and said, good luck, and they left. So I was there, got saved by some construction workers who were building camps for Blue Helmet United Nations soldiers. And they said, well, we have a container free, why don't you move in there, we'll put a bed. And I stayed there inside that UN base camp for weeks to find out what was happening there. Really interesting. There was a big contrast between what I read in the newspapers about UN operations. In the newspapers, I would read how lazy UN soldiers were and that they didn't do anything and they just stood there doing nothing when women and children were being killed. And what I saw in reality was a UN force, blue-helmeted soldiers from very poor countries, and also without a mandate to do anything, without guns to do anything, and without military backup from other countries to do anything. So this contrast between what I read in the newspapers and what I actually saw on the ground was quite large. I decided to follow more UN peacekeeping operations. I went to the peacekeeping operation in Haiti, then I went to Rwanda. We all know how that ended and how the UN soldiers there were blamed. And in the year 1999, I followed the Blue Helmets as a journalist into Sierra Leone in West Africa. At that moment, the largest UN operation was being built up there. 1999, the civil war in Sierra Leone was still raging. Only the capital was in the hands of Blue Helmet soldiers, and a small coastal part was also in their hands. The rest of the country was in the hands of rebels. It was a very dark time in Sierra Leone. People had, for example, run out of gasoline. So it was people could not start up their generators anymore. So we had no electricity. We were living by oil lamps and by candlelight. And it was very, very difficult to use computers or televisions. People had run out of batteries to put inside their transistor radio, so there was no news from outside. Otherwise, in Africa, people listened to BBC World Service, for example, on their transistor radios. There wasn't any because people were not playing their radios anymore, and there was also no music. So it was dark, it was silent, and people were really depressed because the war had been going on for over 10 years, and it was a really cruel war. You may remember the war. It was the war where rebel soldiers were cutting off the hands and the feet of people with machetes and axes. And those people actually became the icons, the victims without hands, they became the icons of this war. But still, there was some action. Outside Sierra Leone, the United Nations was negotiating a peace accord between the government and between rebel soldiers. We in Sierra Leone itself, we did not hear a lot about it because, as I said, there was no radio and no television. But the peace accord was signed at a certain stage. And with the peace accord was made available a huge amount of aid money. Money to rebuild Sierra Leone. And the moment that this aid money was relieved, Sierra Leone became from nothing a what we call donor darling. It became the best financed humanitarian operation at that moment on the planet. I believe in that first year of peace and rebuilding in Sierra Leone, the amount of almost $1 billion was made available by the donor countries. So within a very short period of time, I saw the capital of Sierra Leone, Freetown, change from this dark and very silent place into a quite lively place. Within a very short period of time, almost 300 international aid organizations moved in. So you literally saw this caravan of white Land Rovers, and they had brought gasoline and they had brought generators. So there was sound again, and the generators were going, we had light again. Also very important at the moment is that inside Freetown, the restaurants opened up again because all those white aid workers, they needed a place to go in the evening. Offices opened, nice places were being rent out for aid workers to live in. And a very sort of mark in the peace of Sierra Leone was the official opening of the golf course. Because the aid workers needed some sort of entertainment. So at first I was quite enthusiastic. I really thought, yes, we're saved, you know. The world has now put his eyes upon us and we will now be rescued and the country will be rebuilt and all those poor people will be helped. But because I had been there for quite a long time, I knew the players, I knew who was who in Freetown. So what I noticed was that the aid organizations, they were actually immediately finding a connection with the political elite in Sierra Leone. And it was the political elite who was actually very guilty of the war. They kept the war going much too long and they were guilty of causing the war. It was also the business elite in Sierra Leone that got connection with the aid workers. The people who during the war had made their money out of trading arms, for example, and after the war they were making their money out of renting houses, renting office space and renting vehicles to the aid workers. And it was also the rebel elite, the people who were the most guilty in the war, the people who had been handling their axes and their machetes to cut people's hands off. They were the ones who got access to all that aid money that was made available. And the people that I considered the vulnerable and the really poor, the ones that did not belong to the elite, they had no access to the aid. They were left and they were standing there looking how the bad guys were actually making the most profit and the most advantage of this aid. And I thought that this was wrong because I always had thought that aid was there for the poor and for the vulnerable. So I decided to check if this was also going on in other aid operations. I went to Sierra Leone's neighboring country, Liberia. There was also an aid operation there. I went to Congo, I went to Ivory Coast, went to Afghanistan. I studied the aid operations going on in Darfur, for example, in Sudan. I studied the history of humanitarian aid, the operations that you may have known, heard about in Biafra in the 60s and in the 80s in Ethiopia. And I discovered that we were not looking at an incident, that what I had seen happening in Sierra Leone, that the elites, the persons that I would call the bad guys in the war, in all those countries, I saw the same pattern. It was the elites that had the easiest access to the war and the elites that made the most easy connection to the aid organizations. And for some reason, the aid organizations, even if it happened every time, it was a repeating a process going on, the aid organizations did not seem to be prepared for that. They had no plan for that. What I actually saw was in Sierra Leone, 300 organizations moving in. In Afghanistan, it's over 2,000 aid organizations that moved in. On the average humanitarian hotspot, a well-funded, popular crisis, you can see 1,000, on the average, 1,000 aid organizations coming along. And those aid organizations do not seem to be prepared for what is waiting for them, for the fact that the elites, and in war countries those will be the war elites, that the elites actually have the easiest access to the aid organizations and to the aid money. And I was wondering why aid organizations didn't seem to be prepared. What I saw was in Sierra Leone 300 aid organizations not working together to prevent the bad guys from taking advantage of the aid, but 300 organizations working separately on their own little projects with their own donors, with their own agendas, and they were not cooperating with each other to make a fist against the abuse of the aid that they were that they could have expected to happen. And I saw that in all those countries where aid operations were mounted, aid organizations not working together to make that fist against the abuse. I wondered why, and in the end I came to the conclusion that we are looking at that aid is actually a sort of an industry. I will paint you a short picture of this industry. There are over 70 official donors. It's the German government, the Dutch government, American government, the biggest one. The European Commission is also a donor organization, and all those more than 70 donor organizations, they make available for foreign aid in general the amount of almost $130 billion per year. I believe that that is a lot of money. This money is not including all the money that you and I take out of our pocket to give 10 euros to our favorite charity if they ask for it. We, as private citizens, we add several billion dollar more on top of that 130 billion. It's an unknown amount because there is no central administration. Every charity will raise its own funds and they will administrate it separately. So we don't know how much, but it's billions that we take out of our pockets. So you have this enormous amount of money, and then the United Nations Development Programme once made an effort to count how many aid organizations there are, international aid organizations, and they stopped counting at 37,000. So you have this huge amount of money, you have this huge amount of aid organizations who want a part of that money. And obviously, if you are an aid organization, you want as much for your own organization and you want the competition to get as little as possible. It's a very logical thing. If you want to survive as an organization, you must make sure that the donor gives his money to you and not to a competing organization. And believe me, amongst 37,000 aid organizations, there's a lot of competitions going on. So we are looking at an industry where the market laws are actually working. There's nothing surprising about that, it's only logical. What I found most interesting in my journeys through all these disaster areas and war zones was that not only for the aid organization, aid is an industry, but also for the people who receive the aid, it is an industry. If you bring aid money or aid goods like rice and like tents and vehicles and computers and satellite radios, etc., if you bring aid money and aid goods into a war zone, then it is only logical that those parties fighting inside that war zone will do their very best to get as much of that aid as they can, and they will do their very best to make sure that the enemy gets as little of the aid as they can. Also, that is really logical. You would be a really bad military if you would allow aid organizations to feed your enemy and make him strong so he can actually beat you up. So it's very logical processes, and for some reason that I didn't figure out for a long time, the aid industry was not taking precautions against these very logical things that are happening inside war zones. It doesn't only work like this in war zones. I discovered that it works like this every time an aid operation is mounted. What you see is those aid organizations competing with each other. They do not go into a certain disaster zone with a communal plan. They go there with their own plan because the competition Because you as an aid organization have to make sure that your organization is stronger than the other organization, is somewhere quicker than the other organization, has more clients than the other organization. You have to make sure that the donor chooses you as the receiver of the aid and not the competition. So this eternal battle in competition is what makes the humanitarian aid industry actually, which is the pulping heart of the humanitarian aid industry. They themselves, they realize that this is happening, they themselves call it that they are trapped inside what they call the humanitarian dilemma. Aid organizations obviously want to do good for others, they save lives. I'm not denying that aid organizations are doing, they want to do good for others, but they need to do good for themselves too. So that means they have to survive as an organization. So that means that if necessary, aid organizations are obliged to themselves to serve their own interest first, their own organizational interest, before the interest of victims. If it is in the interest of your organization, then that is the choice you will have to make. You can see plenty very painful examples of what happens then, of the consequence of the fact that aid organizations have to choose for their own survival and not for what is best for the victims. There are some classical examples, like for example in Goma in 1994. You may remember this was in the aftermath of the genocide in Rwanda, when we saw on television a million refugees coming over the mountains of Rwanda, coming down the mountains and descending on the Great Lake region of Africa, in outside the border of Rwanda, in what was then called Zaire. At that time on TV, we heard that there was something wrong in Rwanda. There was something like a genocide going on, but was it the Hutsis and the Tutsis, or was it? We didn't really know. There were no journalists there. What we saw on television was 1 million desperate people climbing over that mountain, taking their bicycles, carrying their elderly and their babies, and they were desperate and they had cholera, etc. And we watched that on television, and we were all so touched by this because we saw all this human suffering there. And because these people were so desperate, we were all presuming that these people were the survivors of the genocide. In fact, they were not. They were the perpetrators of the genocide. Amongst those refugees, there was the entire Hutu extremist government, there was the entire Hutu extremist army, and there was the entire Hutu extremist militia who had helped to do this genocide in Rwanda. But the aid organizations knew this. I was there at the time as a journalist, and I could see the militias carrying around the machetes with which they had been killing people in Rwanda. There were even tanks parked in between the refugee tents, you know. There were army helicopters parked in between the refugee camps. So the aid organizations there, more than 100 international aid organizations, they all realized what was happening. They all realized who these people were, and they didn't do anything against it. Why? Because Goma at that time was the humanitarian hotspot of the world. There was a lot of donor money going there, and aid organizations had to make sure that they were part of the action, because if you didn't go there being an aid organization, your competition would go there and they would profit from the aid money flowing, and your organization wouldn't. It's dangerous for the survival of your organization. So aid organizations bring themselves into this position a lot. You can see it today in Afghanistan. Afghanistan is known in the aid world as the billion-dollar black hole. There is almost no control over what is happening to the aid money there. Lots of the aid money disappears without being accounted for. There are strong suspicions that a large part of this money, and we're talking millions of dollars, that a large part of this money is actually disappearing into the pockets of warlords and the Taliban. Aid organizations are not doing anything against it because Afghanistan is where you need to be as an aid organization. So it is a very big dilemma that the aid organizations keep themselves in because they function in this competitive environment. Like I said before, it is not only in war zones that this is happening. I was in Haiti recently to see what was happening with the aid operation there. And what you see again there is, in the case of Haiti, more than 10,000 aid organizations there who are doing their own projects and who are not working towards a communal goal. They work with their own donor money in competition with each other. In Haiti, it is not so much the bad guys that profit. In Haiti, you have an entirely different problem because the aid organizations are not combining their efforts, and that is gaps in the aid. You know that there was an earthquake there in January 2010. Half the city of Port-au-Prince collapsed, huge apartment buildings, hospitals, universities, the palace, the cathedral, it collapsed. The rubble of the earthquake is still there. Only 5% has been cleaned up, and before the rubble is cleaned up, I mean, it is as high as the ceiling here, the rubble. You cannot rebuild Haiti until the rubble is being cleared. It is not being done because aid organizations choose to do other projects. The money is there, but they have the freedom to choose other projects that they themselves find more interesting. They don't need to make the interest of the country of Haiti, of the people of Haiti, they don't need to make that into their own priority. They have that freedom and nobody can stop them. Another very sad gap in the aid of Haiti, in Haiti, is that there are the cholera epidemic. From day one after the earthquake, the cholera epidemic was predicted. It was going to happen. The circumstances for cholera were ideal. A lot of aid money came in. Nobody could force the aid organizations to actually prevent the cholera epidemic, even if that was in the best interest of the Haitian people that they had raised the funds for. So the cholera epidemic happened. There's a second epidemic coming on, and still there's not enough aid organizations doing anything to prevent that. They are spending their money on things they themselves find a priority. So they make their own choices. So what you see now in Haiti is that 500,000 people still live on top of the rubble inside tents. The people living inside those tents have to share one toilet with 300 people. Only 10% of the people in Haiti have access to clean water. They're not getting it, so the next cholera epidemic is coming. Half of the money raised for Haiti is still inside the bank accounts of Haitian aid organizations, and it's not happening. They can spend it like themselves. The aid organizations don't seem to be able to change themselves very quickly. They acknowledge this problem of not working together, of competing with each other and leaving gaps. I think the aid organizations need some help. They need help from journalism. There needs to be a lot more journalism about what actually makes the aid world tick, the humanitarian dilemma. And it's also help from you in the audience. It is your money they're working with. I believe that even if you only give 10 euros, even then it is your responsibility that you have to make as sure as you possibly can that aid organizations spend that in the best interest of the people that they claim to be working for. So my advice to you, my message to you would be, before you donate money, ask as many questions to the aid organization as you possibly can. Thank you.